I'm Anthony M. Elmore, president and founder of the Safari Initiative Foundation. At the Safari Initiative Foundation, our goal is to bring the African and the African-American family together. Today, we're bringing you an exciting lecture. Now, our lecture is about Tom Mboya, the greatest African hero in modern time. It was Tom Mboya who was responsible for Barack Obama Sr. coming to America. Now, it is very difficult to understand Tom Mboya. Most importantly, however, what we bring in our lecture is that we bring an African-American perspective of Tom Mboya. You see, the idea of the cause of President Obama actually came from the Black Revolutionary Movement, and we're going to explain this in this lecture. Now, it was Whitney Young who said, "It is better to be prepared for an opportunity and not have one than to have an opportunity and not be prepared." Now, in 1992, I had the opportunity to meet Kenyan President Daniel Arap Moi. Now, why would a president meet Anthony F. Elmore? Today, I want to meet with Kenyan President Uhuru Kenyatta, and I want to meet with American President Barack Obama Jr. Today, I can confidently tell President Uhuru Kenyatta and American President Barack Obama Jr. that Anthony F. Elmore represent the spirit of Kenyan hero Tom Mboya. Now, while these presidents may not have time for Anthony F. Elmore, they should respectfully acknowledge the spirit of Tom Mboya. Thomas Joseph Mboya is Africa's most influential citizen in regards to an African's mark on America's culture and history. While the world knows the influence of Dr. Martin Luther King in regards to American culture and history, most who look at President Barack Obama Jr. do not realize that because of a Kenyan by the name of Thomas Joseph Mboya, we have a Barack Obama Jr. And if it was not for Thomas Joseph Mboya, there may not have been a Kenyan president, Uhuru Kenyatta, or an independent nation called Kenya. Tom Mboya brokered America's most broadest, long-standing relationship between America, Americans, and the African-American community in the history of any African in world history. In the case of world leaders in history, some men are inspired by the spirit of past world leaders from history, but there are rare cases where the spirit of an historic world leader inspires an individual. In the case of me, Anthony F. Elmore, I believe that it was the spirit of Tom Mboya that entered my soul to tell his story. I believe that Tom Mboya entered my soul because I would be a conduit who could tell and relate the spirit of Tom Mboya. Now, I was the first in Kenya. I first, rather, went to Kenya in 1990. And the spirit of Mboya touched my soul. I had no idea that it was the spirit of Tom Mboya until about 20 years later. Until the spirit revealed itself to me. Now, July the 5th, 2019, marks the 50th anniversary of the death of Tom Mboya. And we're asking the government of Kenya to honor the legacy of Tom Mboya, honoring the spirit of Mboya via practicing Harambe, via putting together Africans and Americans. The putting together of African and Americans is the true spirit of Tom Mboya. In the history of Africans and America, no African country has ever honored African Americans with a formal state reception. Before there was ever a country called Kenya, there was a 26-year-old East African by the name of Tom Mboya who came to America, and this Kenyan helped change the world. This Kenyan story should be told in a movie. This is not just a Kenyan story. The Tom Mboya story is perhaps the greatest African. It's a story perhaps the greatest African in modern history. Certainly, if he's not the greatest African, he is the most influential African in modern history. And Tom Mboya has a son-in-law, Dr. Evans Cordero, who's got enough money. He could put up the money to help do a movie, because there should be a movie on Tom Mboya. Now, what is the moral of this story? The moral of this story is that together, we can work together to help change our world. Please realize that the change in the character of one single individual is enough to change the destiny of a nation. And this is what Tom Mboya did. Now, because Tom Mboya touched my soul and spirit, there is not any American who understands, lives, works, or who is dedicated to promoting the dream and the spirit of Thomas Joseph Mboya more than Anthony Elmore. Moreover, in regards to America and Tom Mboya, we are the most qualified person in the world who can tell the black American perspective of Tom Mboya. Now, that is a picture of me. 3 years ago, I went to honor Tom Mboya at Rasinga Island in Kenya. Certainly, you in Kenya know and understand the Kenyan perspective of Tom Mboya, but it is Anthony F. Elmore who understands the black American perspective of Tom Mboya. It was Anthony Elmore who traveled to Kenya in 2013 to ask Kenyans to come together to produce the Tom Mboya movie. We must tell the story of Tom Mboya in a movie, and certainly I would like to write the movie and direct the movie. Now, in regards to writing the Tom Mboya story or telling the Mboya story, we Americans are better suited than actually the Kenyans. Now, let me explain why. Tom Mboya was a pan-Africanist. Now, a pan-Africanist is an ideology and movement that encourages the solidarity of Africans worldwide. It is based on the belief that unity is vital to economic, social, and political progress, and aims to unify and uplift people of African descent. Now, being a Pan-Africanist does not mean that you dislike white people. It simply means coming together as a people to build your country, to build your nation, and to help uplift your people. While Tom Mboya was born in the Luo tribe in Kenya, he was not just a Luo. He was a Kenyan, and beyond being a Kenyan, he was an African, and beyond being an African, he was a human. What is the Tom Mboya story about? The Tom Mboya story is about opportunity. We must come together to create a world where all humans have equal opportunity. What is most important for us is to provide opportunity. In the case of Anthony F. Elmore, I am doing this lecture asking Kenyan President Uhuru Kenyatta to help me to make an opportunity for youth not only in Kenya, but I am asking the Kenyan President to help me make an opportunity for youth all over the world. Now, in the 1950s, Kenyan President Jomo Kenyatta, before there was Kenya, was put in jail by the British because he asked for an opportunity for Kenyan people. I am a black man in America asking a black leader for the opportunity to make a difference not only in the country of Kenya, but we want to make a difference in Africa. It is not a white man who has the power to say yes or no. It is a black leader who has the power. We come to Kenya not just as Anthony F. Elmore. We come to Kenya representing the spirit of Thomas Joseph Mboya. There's one thing that I learned about Mr. Thomas Joseph Mboya. Someone gave Thomas Joseph Mboya a chance or an opportunity. Now, before I get deep into my lecture, I as an African American has an advantage over the average African in regards to Tom Mboya. See, while we African Americans do not know which tribe or African ethnic group we belong to, we also do not carry a prejudice or a myopic view of tribalism. See, we in America faced racism, and the white races treated all of us the same. In Africa, you have both the blessings of knowing your ethnic background, but you also face the curse of tribalism that tears Africans and Africa apart. Thomas Joseph Mboya was not a tribalist, but he was a Pan-African. Now, we in this lecture speak about Tom Mboya from the authority of a broad view of our American's perspective. See, too many Kenyans, when they see or hear about Tom Mboya, many see a Luo man. Most Americans have no knowledge as to what is a Luo man. Most Americans cannot even name five ethnic groups in Africa, let alone knowing over the 70 ethnic groups in Kenya. The average American does not know the proximity of East Africa and Kenya, or West African Ghana. To black Americans, Africans are just Africans. Now, most Americans have never heard of Tom and Mboya. And there is no movement or effort in America to introduce Tom and Mboya to America. It is only Anthony Elmore from Memphis, Tennessee, who is struggling, who is fighting for the legacy of Thomas, Joseph, and Mboya to be heard in America. Our opponents in promoting Tom and Mboya are not white people. It has been kings in Africa who challenge our idea of promoting Tom and Mboya. In fact, in 2013, the governor, Cornel Rasanga, of Siaya County in Western Kenya. Now, this is the county where the Obama family comes from. Cornel Rasanga came to Memphis, Tennessee. Instead of him promoting tourism to have people come to Kenya to create jobs, Cornel Rasanga and almost the entire legislative body of Kenyans came to Memphis, Tennessee to cut a side deal with Tennessee State Representative G.A. Hardaway. And I complained about this. I was so hurt and so embarrassed. I said, man, you guys from Kenya are not following the spirit of Tom and Mboya, who came to America, and his goal was to help Kenyans to get a scholarship, to get an education, not to help themselves. And those Kenyan leaders looked at me and they laughed and said, Tom and Mboya is dead. Now, these are Lua people from the Lua tribe in Siaya County. These are people who from the era where Tom and Mboya family comes from, yet they embarrass or they contaminate or insult the spirit of Tom and Mboya. In fact, this was in the Kenyan newspapers because I got in a big war trying to protect the legacy of Tom and Mboya. Now, it is difficult to understand Tom and Mboya without understanding the history of both America and Africa. Tom and Mboya came to America in 1956. In America, we Americans faced slavery and Jim Crow laws, whereas the Kenyans, they in 1956, Kenya was a British colony, or British protectorate. And in 1956, when Tom and Mboya came to America, the first Kenyan president, Jomo Kenyatta, and Oginga Odinga, and all the Kenyan leaders, and anybody who had the idea of doing any resistance, they all were locked up in jail. Now, it is difficult to understand why someone would invite a labor leader to America, because it's difficult to understand, but please understand that in Kenya, all the leaders were locked up, and the only person who was a leader among black people who were legally sanctioned was a labor leader. Tom and Mboya had stopped the strike in Mombasa, and he had did some great things, and he was a labor leader, and he had a chance to go to London. And while in London, he wrote a book called The Kenyan Question, An African Answer. Now, he was 25 years old when he went to London, and he wrote this book. Now, the British didn't like the idea of Tom and Mboya writing a book. They were not about to make no African a leader, but he was a good alternative because he was a Lua man, and the other Lua man was Oginga Odinga, who was the father of the former Kenyan Prime Minister Raila Odinga. Now, Oginga Odinga, he supported the idea of the Soviet Union a communist like Nelson Mandela, because people were trying to be free and he was not objecting to socialism, whereas America and the British, they had a thing against socialism. But when Tom and Mboya wrote this book, now prior to writing the book as a trade unionist, he made communication to the trade unions in America so they were aware of Tom and Mboya. Now, so you can understand the story, you have to get an idea about trade unions. You see, before there was a Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., there was a man in America who was very famous, who was very successful in civil rights. His name was Asaph Philip Randolph. Now, A. Philip Randolph, or Asaph Philip Randolph, was a founder of the Black Union, called the Black Pullman Porters Union, Sleeping Porters Union. Now, around 1955, there was a union called the American Federation of Labor, or AFL, and then there was the CIO, that's the Congress of, that's the Congress of Organization. Now, the AFL-CIO, they were labor organizations that supported the Black movement. Now, what they did, the AFL-CIO actually built a trade union building in Kenya, and they built a labor college in Uganda. They were the ones who actually helped to make Tom and Mboya a bona fide leader in Kenya. Now, let me be clear. It was Americans who reached out to Tom and Mboya. Now, let's take this thing a bit further. There was a man by the name of James Farmer who was the co-founder of an organization in America called CORE. That's the Congress of Racial Equality. Now, the Congress of Racial Equality was co-founded by a man, a white man by the name of George Hauser. Now, what they did, what CORE did was, CORE was particularly dealing with Black issues in America, and the co-founder, George Hauser, organized an organization called a CORE. We have to understand the circumstances, what happened in August of 1956, and we have to understand this from an African-American perspective. You see, we told you that the organization called a CORE, or American Committee on Africa, wrote a 26-year-old Tom and Mboya to America to speak at colleges. And Tom and Mboya was a great hit because people had this idea that all Africans were living in the jungle, they were had bones in their nose, and they were inarticulate. And but when they saw this brilliant, articulate African, people were very excited because Tom and Mboya was the de facto leader in all of Africa. You see, America did not really have colonies, but the British had colonies. Now, please understand that the British had the Black leaders in Kenya locked up in jail. Now, why is this lecture in regards to Thomas Joseph Mboya important? This lecture is important because we African Americans made the Kenyan liberation struggle inclusive of the Black struggle in America. You see, Africans look at their struggle of Africa and their independence of the British as their struggle. But we in America look at the overall inclusive struggle as one single struggle. It was a part of the Black Revolutionary Movement. Now, in regards to history and building relationship between Americans, African Americans, and Africans, the model and foundation was set in stone by Kenya's Thomas Joseph and Mboya. Looking at the relationship of Tom and Mboya and his relationship in America with African Americans and Americans, it is like looking at a black history book. We have not tapped upon the historic relationship of one of Kenya's founding fathers and the Black Revolution in America. What you in Kenya must understand is that the Black Revolution in America included both black and white people. Moreover, Tom and Mboya was a part of America's Black Revolution. Tom and Mboya first came to America at the age of 26. Actually, he came on his 26th birthday on August the 15th, 1956. Now, other than Ethiopia and Liberia, all African countries were under white colonization. Tom and Mboya was not a lure coming to America, nor was he even a Kenyan. Tom and Mboya came to America as the first African ambassador of a colonized African country. In plain English, Tom and Mboya was the de facto leader of Africa. The most important aspect of this lecture is that Thomas Joseph and Mboya belong in the annals of black history in America. Let us move to America in 1956 when Tom and Mboya first came to America. Now, in 1956, Tom and Mboya was booked to speak at college campuses in America. George Hauser, the president of ACORE, or the American Committee on Africa, scheduled Tom and Mboya to speak on college campuses throughout America. What Tom and Mboya did, Tom and Mboya brought credibility to Africa because he was so articulate, he was so colorful. He could stand up without notes and talk for hours. He was doing as much as 6 lectures a day while he was in America. His lectures were so successful in America, they even had the book 10 Days in Canada. The man was awesome. The man was Africa's greatest representative who could stand toe-to-toe with the best of men. He could go on television where you see him on a picture on Meet the Press. He could talk, and he was articulate. And he, most important, was connected to the black community in America. Now, one of the interesting things that happened that in 1956, Tom and Mboya met a white industrialist or businessman who sold airplane parts. His name was William X. Shimon. Now, William X. Shimon was a young white guy who was interested in changing in the world. And when George Howard introduced Tom and Mboya to William X. Shimon, they hit it off very good. And George Howard asked William X. Shimon to sponsor Tom and Mboya's tours throughout America, pay for his hotels and spend the money, and he had to have books. So everywhere he went, they took his pamphlet, the Kenyan question, they took the book and they passed the book out, and Tom and Mboya integrated himself throughout America. Now we must understand that in 1956, when Tom and Mboya came to America, Dr. Martin Luther King was engaged in Montgomery, Alabama with the Montgomery bus boycott. They had earlier that month, and well, earlier in January, they had bombed his house, and Dr. King was struggling with the boycott in Alabama. Now that was Tom and Mboya speaking to these colleges, and as he spoke at the colleges, he asked the president of those colleges to give Kenyans an education, to give them a scholarship. So now this is how things started. Tom and Mboya asked William X. Sherman to donate money to pay for the airfare so Kenyans could come in and get a college. And one thing led to another and another, and William Sherman was spending so much money that he decided to put together a nonprofit organization called the African American Student Association. That's how the African American Student Association came about, because of William X. Sherman. Now, another thing that happened to Mr. Thomas Joseph Mboya. In 1956, Tom and Mboya met the Calypso singer, Harry Belafonte. Now, in 1956, Harry Belafonte was the first singer in America to sell a million albums. So he was very popular in America. It was like coming to America and getting the support of a Michael Jackson. But not only did he get the support of a Harry Belafonte, but he got the support of a baseball great by the name of Jackie Robinson. And not only did he get the support of a baseball great by the name of Jackie Robinson, but Tom and Mboya also got the support of an actor who had won, who would later come to be an Academy Award winner. His name was Sidney Poitier. So imagine coming to America. Please take your mind to August the 15th, 1956, when Tom and Mboya arrived in the United States. Tom and Mboya was not taken to a hotel in New York. Tom and Mboya was taken to the Brooklyn home of Marty Springer. Now, Marty Springer was born in 1910, and she had a son the same age as Tom and Mboya. Now, she worked as a union representative for the AFL-CIO, and in the 1940s, she really became the first black woman to travel internationally for the union. She traveled in Asia, Africa, and Latin America, and she was known as Mama Maldi. Now, Tom and Mboya stayed at her home, and they became friends. Now, the first meeting that Tom and Mboya had in America in 1956 was with union leaders. Tom and Mboya needed a union building, and the AFL-CIO sent Marty Springer to Kenya. And later, she would bring a check to build the union building in Kenya. And this was support of Tom and Mboya. Now, it was Asaph Philip Randolph that influenced the decision, who got Tom and Mboya this money. more importantly, it was Americans who supported Kenya. So we see Marty Springer in Kenya because she came to support young Kenyans in the garment industry. Now, please understand that AGOA, that's the American Committee on Africa, that brought Tom and Mboya to America, was an organization committed to the liberation of Africa. The organization was founded in 1953 by civil rights leaders George Hauser, who you see in the picture, along with Bayard Rustin. Now, they started a corps in support and fighting against apartheid in South Africa, and later they came to support Kenya. So when you look at a man by the name of Bayard Rustin, these were the guys who put the Martin Luther King, I Have a Dream speech together. They were the ones who put this together. Bayard Rustin was one of the pioneers of the civil rights movement. Now, we could say that Tom and Mboya's trip to America in 1956 was 100% part of the black civil rights struggle in America. Let us explain from the standpoint of black history and an African leader, Thomas Joseph Mboya. See, in 1956, Tom Mboya contacted or was personally in touch with black leaders in America. Now, we are asking the president of Kenya, President Uhuru Kenyatta, to follow the historic path of one of Kenya's founding fathers, Thomas Joseph Mboya, and make a formal connection to the black America. The way that we're asking the Kenyan president, Uhuru Kenyatta, to make a formal connection to African Americans is via honoring African Americans via a formal state reception in Nairobi, Kenya in July of 2019. Why is July of 2019 important? July of 2019 is important because this time marks the 50th anniversary of the tragic death of Tom Mboya. We hold that it's most fitting that we Americans come to Kenya to honor not only the legacy of Tom Mboya, but we want to also honor the legacy of Africans in America who have never been formally invited to come to Africa. But there's also something else that is very important. In 2018, this will also be the 50th anniversary of the death of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in Memphis, Tennessee. And what we want to do in order to properly and fittingly honor the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King, who in his last speech in Memphis, Tennessee, mentioned the name of Johannesburg, South Africa, Accra, Ghana, and Nairobi, Kenya in his last speech in Memphis. We want Kenya to come together with us in Memphis and have a Memphis-Kenya joint celebration, whereas we honor the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King in Memphis in 2018. So it is important that we both honor the legacies of Dr. King and the legacies of Tom Mboya. Now, let's kind of give you an understanding why the legacy of Tom Mboya is important. You see, without a Tom and Mboya, that would have never been a Barack Obama Jr. So in that regard, it is the legacy of Tom and Mboya and the history of Tom and Mboya that helps us to have a Barack Obama Jr. Now, let's kind of tell you what happened. On July the 26th, 1960, then Senator John F. Kennedy, he had just won the Democratic nomination as to run for President of the United States. And he was taking off a few days, and he was going to spend a few days at the Kennedy compound in Hamianas-Port, Massachusetts. Now, President Kennedy at the time was on the Foreign Relations Committee. Now, the reason that Tom and Mboya had to rush to America, because they were doing the second airlift to America and they did not have the funds to charter the jets to bring the Kenyan students. They had millions of dollars in scholarships, but the Kenyans could not pay for it, and they had to raise the money. So they made a last ditch effort attempt and told Mboya, you got to come to America and use your skills to try to help us get money. So what they did, since President Kennedy was on the Foreign Relations Committee and they knew he was going to spend a few days at the Kennedy compound, they arranged for Mboya to come under the auspices of foreign relations and African relations. So the secretary of Kennedy, scheduling secretary, granted Mboya an opportunity to see Kennedy. Now, when he went to the Kennedy compound, man, they got into a great discussion because Tom Mboya was brilliant, he was articulate, and most of all, he told a story of self-help, and he was able to illustrate the importance of Africans getting an education and not being communists and how they can go and change the world. And before he left the Kennedy compound, President Kennedy had offered to give Tom and Mboya, or the students in Kenya, $15,000. That means $5,000 three times under the auspices that he keep it quiet. Now, this is what happened. This was on July the 26th. Now, on July 27th and 28th, it was confirmed that no one was going to help these Kenyan students. And then Senator Kennedy told his brother-in-law, Sergeant Schreiber, who was running the Kennedy Foundation, he said, talk to other people and let them know that the Kennedy is on the board here and let's try to help these African students. Well, what happened was, Sergeant Schreiber reported back to his brother-in-law that no one would get on board. And do you know that Senator John F. Kennedy made a commitment to give not only $100,000, but he made the commitment to give $200,000 for the plane and another $100,000 to support these young Africans, but just keep it quiet. Now, what happened was, you had the Kennedy election. Now, we're talking July 29th, 1960. Now, Vice President Nixon was also running for president against John F. Kennedy, and he was Republican, and most African Americans were Republicans. Now, what happened was, the black people and everyone had asked Richard Nixon to help the Kenyan students, and the State Department turned them down. But word got out that the Kennedy was gonna give these guys $100,000, and Nixon pulled strings and said, y'all give these Kenyans $100,000, and don't y'all take the Kennedy money, take this American State Department money. Now, Tom and Boyd in the group said, well, we're not going to turn our back on Kennedy. Why don't y'all just give some other folk that $100,000? But anyway, there was this Senator Scott that made a big stink about the whole deal. What he said was Kennedy was trying to buy the black vote by the Kennedy Foundation outbidding the American government. And man, you had Fulbright and all the senators. I mean, this thing was a big imbroglio. It was the biggest news ever in America because they had accused the Kennedys of trying to use their influence and money to buy the black vote. You see, in 1960, there were now enough black people registered to vote that could turn the tide of the election, and the black vote was very, very important. But a big stink came about. But they had a senatorial investigation on the matter, and when they looked at the records, they had saw that Kennedy had only committed to $15,000, and they found out that the State Department had reneged or had turned them down. And what they found out was there was a man named John F. Kennedy who had a heart and a love big enough to help African people. Now, what happened was, this story of what Kennedy did went all over the black press. And what happened was this softened the black press, who was not supportive of Kennedy, for number one, because blacks were Republicans. Number two, Kennedy was a Catholic, and blacks didn't support Catholics in those days. But it was because of what John F. Kennedy did that it changed the tide of the election. Now, we move to September of 1960. Kennedy gave these students money to come to America, and you see on the picture where these students came to Senator Kennedy's office, and they presented him with an African stool and a thank you. So there you are seeing these nice, clean-cut Kenyans, and you got this picture plastered all over America and the black press, where you got these black Africans being supported by a white senator. These pictures were so important that it changed the election. Now, in October, Kennedy went to Harlem, New York. And he had the vice president with him. He had a lot of people with him. And it was Kennedy that told the people that we in America must educate African leaders. Now, Jackie Robinson had endorsed Richard Nixon, and even Dr. King's daddy and all the black ministers had supported Nixon. But what Kennedy did, Kennedy made a brochure that he passed around everybody in his newspapers and all his publicity. What you see was Kennedy helping African students. Ladies and gentlemen, to make a long story short, what Kennedy did was he was able to change the minds of African Americans, and it was because of Tom Mboya. Kennedy put the picture of him and Tom Mboya together when they met on July 26th, and he put this on a brochure. So what you have is a Kenyan leader in the middle of the politics in America in 1960. along with Kennedy helping Dr. Martin Luther King get out of jail, and the idea of President Kennedy helping these Africans. This was the way that Kennedy was elected President of the United States of America, because of Tom Mboya and the efforts of Kenya to help Africans. We had President John F. Kennedy to be elected president, and Tom Mboya, one of the founding fathers of Kenya, helped us get John F. Kennedy elected. And by John F. Kennedy getting elected president, this changed the history in America. The election of John F. Kennedy as President of the United States of America was actually a part of the Black Revolution. Please understand that the Black Revolution was not a revolution of only Black people, but the Black Revolution was the change in America. Thanks to Tom Mboya, African Americans were originally Republican and the party of Abraham Lincoln, but because of the influences of Tom Mboya, African Americans are now Democrats because they were with John F. Kennedy. Now I want you to look at pictures of John F. Kennedy, and what you see in the Revolution of America, you see John F. Kennedy, who got killed, assassinated. You see Robert Kennedy, who got assassinated. You see Dr. Martin Luther King. And throughout America, in the homes of Black America, the revolution was, you saw a John F. Kennedy picture in almost every African American home in America. So for you to look at a John F. Kennedy, a Dr. Martin Luther King, and a Robert Kennedy, you see the change in the revolution in America. What you don't know, or what you didn't know, is that it was a young Kenyan who came to America at 26 years old by the name of Tom Mboya who made the difference. Now, let's go back to 1959. Now, in 1959, there was a singer, Harry Belafonte, who was a singer. There was Jackie Robinson, and there was Sidney Poitier. These Black men used their names to help raise money for the first Airlift America in 1959. And these Black men helped, but it was also the work of Tom Mboya that made the difference. You see, ladies and gentlemen, what the stories do not tell about Tom Mboya is that how Tom Mboya was ingrained and inclusive to Black history in America. One of the things I want you to look at is that on April the 18th in 1959, Tom Mboya joined a march. It was a youth rally march, and you see the words of Dr. Martin Luther King on the wall. This is pre I Have a Dream march in Washington, D.C. And Tom Mboya actually marched with Dr. Martin Luther King.
A human struggle. The struggle in Africa is one for nothing less and nothing more than the eradication of poverty, disease, and ignorance. And in this context, you and ourselves are all engaged in the same struggle that can aptly be summarized in terms of the struggle for
political freedom, for economic opportunities, and for human dignity. This is my message to you. And I, and millions of other people, join you today in solidarity for the success of the struggle in which we are all involved.
So, they don't tell the story that how ingrained Tom and Mboya was in the black community. But in 1959, Tom and Mboya marched with Dr. Martin Luther King. I also want you to look at a picture. I think this was on April the 30th of 1959 on the cover of Jet Magazine. Jet Magazine was the premier publication, the premier black publication in America, and you have Tom and Mboya on the cover of Jet Magazine. Ladies and gentlemen, when you make the cover of Jet Magazine, you are making black history. So Tom and Mboya, when he came to America in 1959, he was ingrained in the black community. There he is on the cover of Jet Magazine. But more importantly, when you are a leader in the black community, you are celebrated and honored by the black community. Now, ladies and gentlemen, in May of 1959, Thomas Joseph Mboya received an honorary doctorate degree from Howard University in America. It was just a month ago in America where President Obama spoke at Howard University. Howard University was started after slavery by the Freedmen's Bureau. And this is where some of the greatest recipients, like the first black Nobel Peace recipient, came from Howard University. A Thurgood Marshall came from Howard University. And in 1959, Howard University awarded Thomas Joseph Mboya a doctorate degree. This shows you how much he is ingrained in the black community. Also, I want you to look at a picture. In May of 1959, Dr. Martin Luther King did a fundraiser. The SCLC, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, did a fundraiser for Kenyan students. And Dr. Martin Luther King picked up Tom and Mboya at the airport. And you see what Reverend James Abernathy, King's aide. And then you see Horace Mann, who was the Horace Mann Bond, who was the father of Julian Bond. But he was also a college president. And you see Dr. Martin Luther King, and you see Tom and Mboya, and you see Mr. Clement, who was the president of Atlanta University. You see, Tom and Mboya, ladies and gentlemen, was a part of not only American history, but he was a part of black American history, because Horace Mann Bond, he was first of all the president of Fort Valley State College, and later he became the first black president of Lincoln University in Pennsylvania. And Rufus Clement was the president of Atlanta University. So, in 1959, when organizing the first Aleph, it was a point that black people had gave $1, $2 and $3. And one of the things that you must understand, that in regards to Kenya, it was who's who, from Congressman Charles Diggs to actor Sidney Poitier, Jackie Robinson. But The question was, it was not a matter of who was connected to Kenya. The question was, who was not connected to Kenya? When the Kenyans came to America, you see the author of Raising in the Sun, Lorraine Hansberry, who coined the phrase, young, gifted, and black. She's with the Kenyan students. You see Jackie Robinson with the Kenyan students. You see black nationalist leader Malcolm X with the Kenyan students. Tom and Mboya brought us Americans and us Africans together because we were one people. On July the 5th in 1969, when they killed Tom and Mboya, or whoever assassinated Tom and Mboya, they broke the connection between Africans and African Americans because Tom and Mboya brought us together. It was Robert Kennedy who came to Kenya. It was the Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall who came to Kenya. African Americans were coming to Kenya. In fact, in 1963, when Kenya gained its independence, it was the founder of Jet and Ebony magazine, John H. Johnson, who was the American ambassador to Kenya. Kenya and America was connected. But when they killed Tom and Mboya, they separated Americans and they separated African Americans and Kenyans. But what happened is that in 2008, was that November the 4th, 2008, the spirit of Tom and Mboya arose again, because it was the election of African-American President Barack Obama Jr. who connected us Africans and African-Americans together. Now we're connected together eternally because Barack Obama Jr. father is from Kenya. Now, understand, Barack Obama Sr., who came to America, he came to America based on the spirit of Tom and Mboya. Tom and Mboya from 1956 started bringing Kenyans to America. And because they had started the movement, Tom and Mboya created a culture where Kenyans could now come to America and go to school on a scholarship. And when Barack Obama Sr. came to America, it was some Americans who spent the money to pay for the airfare so Barack Obama Sr. could come to America and go to Hawaii. It was the culture that Tom and Mboya created by Africans coming to America to go to school. When you look at Kenya today, you will find that half of the people in parliament and in government jobs were people who were influenced by Tom and Mboya. Now, the leaders in Kenya, while Tom and Mboya was connected to the African-American community, the Kenyan leaders have not been connected to the community. We are all family. And our goal for 2019 is to find and connect the spirit of Tom and Mboya by bringing African-Americans to Kenya. We have the idea of a program called, instead of Airlift America, we shall join together and have a program called Airlift Africa, whereas we will bring thousands of African Americans to Africa, and together we celebrate the great legacy of Tom and Mboya in a celebration called a Safari Homecoming Celebration. Let's do this in 2019. Let us encourage the President of Kenya, Uhuru Kenyatta, to formally invite African Americans to come to Kenya. Let's ask President Obama to be the keynote speaker. Let's come together as a family and celebrate. I am Anthony F. Elmore, President of the Safari Initiative Foundation, helping to bring the African and African American and Americans together as family. This song comes from America to promote unity in Kenya. I'm gonna tell the people they should have cried, sun should rise again. Tom Mboya, the unsung hero of the man without a song. We're gonna sing his praises until justice is done. Until it's done. In 1956, the age of 26, he came to the USA. He had a dream that Kenya would be free someday. He said, if Kenya's gonna be an independent nation, the youth are Kenya, the edge are Kenya. Tom Mboya started adding the runner, Tom Mboya won. One of those Kenya students, he had a famous son. I'm gonna tell brothers and brothers, the word from Mboya, you wouldn't be a mother. Tom Mboya, the unsung hero, man without a song. We're gonna sing his praises until justice is done. Until it is done. He said, we're gonna be an independent nation. We gotta get a youth in education. Tom Mboya started out in America. Tom Mboya won. One of the Kenya students, he had a famous son. I'm gonna tell President Obama, thanks to Mboya, you are among us. Tom Mboya told the African people to put aside your tribe. He said, look inside yourself and find a national pride. Tom said, one people we're gonna be. We're gonna live as Kenyans in harmony, practicing the rule of Harambe. Tom Mboya, the unsung hero, the man without a song. We're gonna sing his praises until justice is done. Until it is done. In 1963, the people of Kenya were free. They became a nation. It was Tom Mboya who said, all Kenyan students needed an education. I'm gonna tell President Obama, if it weren't for Mboya, you wouldn't be a mother. Tom Mboya, the unsung hero, the man without a song. We're gonna sing his praises until justice is done. Until justice is done. In 1969, they shot Tom Mboya down. And the people are still crying. I'm here to tell the people nation that cry, because the spirit shall rise again. Tom Mboya was our hero and friend. He educated so many Kenyan students. His spirit shall rise again. Tom Mboya, the unsung hero, the man without a song. But we sing his praises until justice is done. Until justice is done. It is done. It is done. Kenyans come together in unity. It is done. His spirit rise again. Thanks, Mboya. Obama is among us. His spirit rise again.